We're now joined by Philippine Information and Communications Technology Secretary Ivan Oy. Secretary Oy, I know you're on your way to Malacañang, but are you there right now?
Karen, good morning.
Good morning to you. I know you have a busy schedule. So let's start off with this. Will you be extending the SIM registration to, there are reports going around that you will be extending it to another 60 days?
During our discussion yesterday with the telcos and the different stakeholders, there were recommendations for the extension. And it can range between 60 to 120. So we received the reports and we received their identified issues and concerns as to why there are still some people who were not able to register. So today's sectoral meeting in the cabinet will be discussing those things, and thereafter I think we would have a press conference and make a formal announcement whether there will be extension, and if so, how long it will be.
Uh-oh. And Secretary, will you be making that decision today? Will you be having a press conference on the extension today?
Yeah, I think it has to be today because tomorrow is the deadline, and we don't really have time if we delay further the announcement. However, I think the delaying the announcement up to today has actually caused a significant increase in the number of registrants. Before, a month or two ago, I think the average registration was around just 100,000 per day.
Mm-mm.
But for the past 2 weeks, we were hitting more than 1 million registrants mm-hmm. per day.
Uh-oh.
So typical, no? Typical of our bad habit. We're all waiting for the last minute before mm-hmm. we register.
Okay, or do you honestly believe that the reason is also the emergency alert that Globe Telecom put out in the last 2 days, or was it yesterday? Because I got it myself and I wasn't sure. This is where I wanted you to clarify. There's been a debate among people. Do you only register if you're prepaid, or even if you're postpaid, you're registered? Because I'm postpaid, I got the emergency alert, so I registered anyway.
Yes, actually, when you're postpaid, you would have received a notice from your postpaid provider to click just yes to confirm uh-oh. Registration. Mm-mm. And if you did that, you're already registered. The emergency alert was broadcast, so it did not select. It was not selective. It was a shotgun approach where everybody, whether they were registered already or not, postpaid mm-hmm. or prepaid, received that info. It's uh-oh. It's actually one of the last minute ways for us to really make sure that everybody mm-hmm. in their system got the message that we should register before the deadline.
Yeah, but it was quite easy, frankly, because all you needed to do, it gave you instructions to type, to text SIM Reg to 8080. I did it, and then a message from Globe just came back and said, you are now registered.
Yes, it's that simple.
It's really that simple.
So we can figure out why there still are kababayans who still are not able to register. The issues that have come up is that some of them, especially the remote areas, do not have an ID.
Mm.
And therefore, they're having, especially for the prepaid ones. However, we've actually liberalized the registration and allowed even barangay-issued IDs.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, the barangay halls, the barangay captains are easily accessible. So they should be able to get an ID.
Uh-oh. Pero Secretary, I think you should clarify this right now. Kahit po postpaid, dapat mag-register either through the yes na ibibigay nung that could be Smart or itong SIM Reg 8080 ng Globe. But kahit postpaid, you need to do a step to register.
Opo, you need to acknowledge. You need to acknowledge
yes.
that.
Kasi
Yes.
the internal the debate with postpaid subscribers is this. No, we don't have to register, we're postpaid. That's for prepaid. But now you're saying no, both prepaid and postpaid.
Yes. Both have to register, and even the postpaid ones, because you need to validate. Now, sometimes in the postpaid ones, let's say it's your husband who registered the postpaid, but you're the one who's using it.
Yeah.
So you need to acknowledge that it's you. It's really you.
Okay. So some good news today. There's an extension. What do you think, sir? It's 60 days or you'll end up with 120 days?
That's the one that will be deliberated, given the concerns of the telcos and the factors that we need to consider.
And Secretary, what is your response to netizens? I mean, netizens were quite upset. And that emergency alert drew flak from a lot of them because, well, I did get it 4 or 5 times, but I understood why. But others, you had many who were very irritated on Twitter. Anong mensahe niyo po sa kanila, Secretary?
Well, perhaps desperate times require desperate measures. Mm-hmm. We are very concerned for our kababayans who still have not registered. Uh-huh. And, you know, the telcos are using every means possible in order to make sure that nobody can claim that they were never informed, mm-hmm. that they were not aware of this. Because once the deadline expires, there access to their number will be terminated. But, and therefore, they will not be able to make calls. They will not be able to receive calls. Neither can they text. And if they have e-wallets, they mm-hmm. lose that. So it's very important that they should register.
Oo, thank you for this. I know you're rushing to Balacanang, so I'm going to keep this short. But then I do hope you can come back to the show again. So there's so many issues to talk about telco. But I wanted to ask you, what action are you taking considering that over 1.2 million records of employees and applicants, you have PNP employee records. You know, there was a massive data breach in these records. What action are you doing, sir?
Well, I'd like to clarify that. No, It was not a hack. It was a data leak. A cybersecurity researcher was going through the web and going through all the different websites, and he happened to find come across a site where there was no security. It was just open to the public. Mm-hmm. And it's just one agency. And in fact, it's a recruitment portal of that agency. Now, because it's a recruitment portal, the public uploads their NBI clearance, their birth certificates, their driver's license, whatever document that they have to submit to the recruitment portal. And therefore, it gave the impression that the people's police clearance, NBI clearance, birth certificates were exposed. Mm-hmm. So these were not breaches of those different government agencies. It's an employment portal or recruitment portal. And so the uploaded documents were the ones that were exposed. So there was no hacking. So it was an unsecured site that was just open and anybody could see it. So he called the attention of our NCERT, our National Computer Emergency Response Team, of this apparent lack of security on this site. And during our investigation, we discovered that this site was actually not professionally developed. In fact, the IT department of that government agency was not even called in order to help design and develop that system. It was a mom and pop operation where somebody just called the friend of the nephew of whatever who referred that someone just probably newly graduated and knew how to do some programming and asked that person to develop and design that site. And because that it is a government agency, they just adopted and used it without even consulting the DICT on what are the best practices and the international standards that should be adopted in terms of cybersecurity, of data protection, and so on. So without going through all that regulatory protection mechanism, it was deployed, and therefore that's the exposure that happened.
Okay, so that's a good clarification, because the person who founded, Jeremiah Fowler, this is correct, no?
Yes, correct.
Claims, yes, that there were documents from the PNP, NBI, BIR, Special Action Force Operations Management Division, Civil Service Commission. So this was a job employment portal, parang correct. Recruiting Filipinos who wanted to work. Tama yun, sir.
To work with the PNP.
PNP only or kahit yung ibang agencies?
PNP lang po.
PNP lang po.
So applicants, okay. Applicants naman yung police.
And what did you do with that particular site, considering he said there were, of course, the birth certificate was there, but may TIN numbers pa na nandun. Kumbaga, ang daming personal info that was in that site. What right. Did so, you act on that site?
Yes, actually, when Mr. Fowler informed our group about that, and he gave us the link to that site, the agency concerned were already advised of that exposure. And as soon as they were advised, it was taken down. So when you go to that site, it's no longer available, and they need to fix that. And at the same time, the National Privacy Commission has already initiated an investigation if there were any protocols that were violated or any laws or rules, so that the people who caused this could properly be made accountable.
Okay, all right. So I think it's important, even the word leaked, because all the news articles state massive data leak. It's like a breach. So it did feel that our own portals were unsafe. The government agency database and the portals were unsafe.
That's why we keep on reminding all the different government agencies. The DICT was created in order to help them with respect to developing world standards, no? And adopting world standards in ICT systems. So they have to stop doing it very unprofessionally, asking people who have no credentials or no certifications as to the quality, and just do it like just an ordinary, even ordinary businesses, they all secure their site. So as they say, little knowledge is dangerous. So so get professional help. We're here, and we can help them get professionally done systems so that they are fully compliant with international security standards and international data standards.
Okay, last two questions. I know you're stepping out of Malacañang soon. One, I recently moderated a cybersecurity forum, and one of the issues there of businesses and experts was the fact that the Philippines didn't accredit cybersecurity firms. Tama ba ito, sir? Like in Singapore, if companies hired a third party, they would get it from an accredited list. Will you be moving to accredit cybersecurity firms?
Yes. We need to ensure that these cybersecurity firms have all the credentials that would provide assurance to the public of their capability. There are a lot who claim to be cybersecurity experts, but when we go through their employees and we go through their consultants, they don't seem to have the necessary international credentials to support that. So we need to verify that.
All right. My last question is, what is your agenda in Malacañang today? Are you seeing the president, sir?
Yes, we'll be discussing the SIM registration among others. And yeah, this is important and this is urgent because tomorrow's already the deadline. So we'd like to make some decisions once and for all. And immediately after that, I believe I'm scheduled for a press conference with the Malacañang Press Corps in order to announce whatever decisions would come up.
All right. On that note, I want to thank you for this interview today, sir. You were in the car. And I'd have to say your data is quite good. Huh? I didn't lose you one bit. All right. Thank you. Thank you, Secretary.
Thank you very much, Karen. You have a good
day. Thank you. You too, sir. DICT Secretary Ivan Uy on the line with us while he was on the move to Malacañang. We're going to take a quick break. Head Start. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Head Start. President Marcos Jr. says he's open to reverting the school break to its old calendar. Marcos said government would study the proposal carefully and consider other factors like COVID cases and changes in the weather.
Since hindi na tayo naka-lockdown, eh balik na lang siguro natin sa dati. But kung kailan kasi ang kailan kalit gagawin, yung actual na semester kung kailan mag-umpisa ang bakasyon ay hindi pa na-decide dahil meron pa rin tayong mga cases na nakikita natin ng COVID na umaakyat na naman, yung replication rate ay umaakyat na naman. Binabagay kasi natin talaga yan sa binabagay natin yan sa seasons . Yun ang naging problema kung paano ko ibabalik ko hindi. Dahil hindi na masabi kung kailan mag-umpisa ang ulan, kung kailan magiging mainit. Ang palagay ko, yung diskusyon na yan, madidesisyonan yan very soon on what will be the, ano yung tama.
Senate Committee on Basic Education Chairman Senator Sherwin Gatchalian earlier said schools should go back to a June to March academic calendar to allow students to have a break during the scorching summer months. Teachers groups, meanwhile, call for long-term solutions to education problems linked to the weather.
Kung ibibigay natin doon sa discretion ng school head, specific po yan, ha? School heads, principals,
yes.
Ibig sabihin.
Yes.
Ano po? Eh, maaring mag-vary, no? Kung paano nila ini-interpret at kung paano i-implement. Strategic dapat yung approach po natin dito. Yeah. Kasi sa totoong buhay, yung dinidiscuss natin, ano, heat index, yung storm warning signal, hindi na pwede na from time to time, pag lumakas ang ulan, eh wala na tayong pasok. Pag uminit, eh wala na tayong pasok, di ba? Dapat i-confront po natin ito. Dapat for classrooms, hiring for teachers, maayos na ventilation, of course, no, lower class size, no?
Uh-oh.
And kung kaya natin, bakit hindi natin bigyan ng aircon, no, yung ating mga classrooms?
All right, we're now joined by the chairman of the House Committee on Basic Education and Culture, Pasig City Representative Roman Romulo. Congressman Romulo, good morning to you, sir.
Yes, good morning, Karen, and to all your listeners and viewers. Good morning to everyone.
All right. This is a big issue for students in public schools. Do you vote for or are you willing to bring back and change the school calendar so that Filipino kids will now have summer vacation April and May instead of June and July? Because for the record, in the country, you do have international schools where in summer vacation is June and July. And then our local schools followed suit. At ngayon gusto namang ibalik. Where do you stand on that, Congressman?
Yes. In fact, Karen, I'm happy that I heard... In the introduction, I heard the president and also the TDC president, Benjo, giving their 2 cents worth. And I agree with what the two of them are saying. The decision of the academic calendar must be based on data and science. The Philippines has only two seasons. It's rainy season and dry season. Mm-hmm. Both have challenges. When it's in the rainy season, As you know, during our time, Karen, when we were still studying, rainy season was the time that we began our school calendar. And during that time, there were many times that we would not have classes because, one, there was flooding. Secondly, there was a big typhoon. And based on the data, I think the DepEd and the executive department should take a look. How many school days do we lose during that time? Now, if you choose the summertime, the dry season, April, May, it also comes to challenges. I think we've heard already anecdotally all the stories of teachers and students saying that there's discomfort. But again, either way, I agree with the president. I agree with Benjo. We should base our decision not solely on. We should look at the data where it would be best for the health and the continuity of the learning of our students. We've suffered so much pre-pandemic, pandemic. There are estimates of a learning loss. I think now we've got the momentum. But of course, we have to take into consideration the health of the students. So I agree. Let's look at the data. Let's ask the experts and let's decide based on that. And moving forward, Karen, there are solutions. I mean, at the end of the day, we should ask the DPWH to make our school buildings either resilient during flooding and strong typhoons, or if it's still going to retain now the academic calendar April, May, then at least well ventilated for the summer season. I think we should prepare for both. And Karen, changing the academic calendar is not that easy.
If you recall, I was going to say, changing the academic calendar, that's quite difficult, right?
Yes. That is why I'm so happy, Karen, that the introduction, I heard the president saying that they are studying it. They are asking experts. They are looking at the data because that is the way we should proceed. It should not be a knee-jerk reaction. It should be something based on data, based on science, and based on consultations. But now, Karen, of course, people will say, well, what happens now? It's so hot. I mean, we hear all these stories. Again, this is the time that we should help each other, whether all parents, students, education stakeholders, all Filipinos. At this point in time, we should help each other. Let's use our common sense. Let's look for practical solutions. Pag-asa always comes out to the forecast. If Pag-asa says tomorrow, it will be so hot or it will be hot, something that is not normal. I think the DepEd has already authorized the school heads, meaning the principals, to call off classes. Again, I think this flexibility should be done now. Secondly, again, even if the Pag-asa does not come up with a forecast that says it's going to be too warm. But again, in your locality, if you see that's the way it is, then adjust. We can have shortened class hours. We can adjust. Again, even the wearing of uniform should be adjusted, because currently what we really have to do is to ensure the safety, the health of our students, but also the continuity of quality education. There are learning losses that we must make up for. Of course, we should while waiting for the decision based on data of whether we should adjust the calendar or not.
Okay. Well, there were several reactions after, I think, last Friday, more than 100 students of the Gulod National High School, the Mamatid Extension in Cabuyao, Laguna, they were hospitalized after showing signs of dehydration and heat exhaustion after taking part in a surprise fire drill in the searing afternoon heat. So my question even is, why would you even have a fire drill? Na sobrang init, di ba? Parang, so, because what do you do in countries where it's always hot? There are countries, don't tell me they don't send their kids to school there.
Yes, that is where the aspect, Karen, of using common sense and
exactly.
I mean, if it's, let's do away first with activities that will be outdoors. Even indoors, if it's a sports activity, the climate is too warm right now, I think common sense would dictate that we cancel these things. What is important for now is that we focus on the subjects, the core subjects that students would need, because we've learned our lesson during the pandemic, not only in the Philippines, but worldwide. Online does not work. Yeah. I mean, we're not prepared for that. No one is prepared for that. I mean, it's a specialized way.
And it's not as effective for young children. That one I have seen in my own kids. I don't know what other parents would say, but online is not effective. Maybe if you're taking your master's, you know what I mean? If you're an adult, pwede. Pero kung bata ka, nag-go online ka, it is not as effective.
Karen, in fact, grades 1 to 3, that is where we are supposed to give the basic the foundational skills, that is reading and mathematics. If you and experts will tell us, when it comes to reading, phonetics is so important. They must be able to tell show the child how each letter, how each word is stated or recited. And that is best done if it is face to face. So that is why that's why it's so important for us to really help one another, especially I think the cooperation of all education stakeholders at this point, because again it's really warm right now. I think we should remind our head teachers, our teachers, our parents, that you know we should use our own judgment right now. If it's too warm, you know, don't allow your child to go to school. The moment they're in school and it's too warm, take a break. Students should take a break. They should ensure that the students are and even the teachers are put in a place that are comfortable. Spread every part.
What can we do, Congressman? The Alliance of Concerned Teachers, they conducted a survey last March 24 to 27. I'm sure you've seen this. So for the benefit of our viewers, I believe that 87% of the 11,706 teachers nationwide who participated in the online survey said, number one, students can't focus on their lessons because of the intolerable heat in public schools. 97% of the respondents said their classrooms only relied on electric fans for ventilation. Alam naman natin, totoo yun. Minsan nga talagang maliit pa yung bintana, di ba? Only 1% had air conditioners. That would be rare in a public school. 2% depend on natural ventilation, meaning malaki yung bintana, doon na lang tayo umasa. So if we don't change, if we don't go back to the June, July, ang tanong is, do we even have the money to improve the classrooms in public schools? Kaya ba yan lagyan ng aircon? That would be very expensive.
First, Karen, when the executive department now is making that decision of whether of the academic calendar, when it should begin, if they reconsider, I think first and foremost, they also should take into account the views, the surveys that are taken. They should take this all into account, not only the science involved. When they make that decision, they should be able to lay it down properly. I know Filipinos are smart. As long as you explain to the Filipino why we've gone, the process of coming to this decision and why you've come to that decision, Filipinos generally are smart. They will accept that. They just need an explanation of the process and how that decision has come about. Secondly, if the decision is to retain the academic calendar covering the months of April and May, then adjustments must come in first. I think the executive department must ask the department, the TPWH, to ensure that future constructions will be well ventilated. Secondly, what adjustments should be done? Thirdly, they should now make decisions on whether or not the school uniform, the class hours are proper during the hot month. And more equally important is already to give a basis for when to suspend classes for head teachers so it does not become subjective.
Kasi ang tanong ko nito, Congressman, listening to you right now, aren't we climate-proofing our classrooms? Like, for example, you are building new classrooms, diba? You are giving out, I hope that Malacanang is listening to this. Why can't the new schools be solar? So if the new schools are solar, then they can afford to put air conditions on classrooms. Kasi solar eh, pero pag hindi kasi you can't afford it. Kasi saan mo kukunin yung panggastos noon? But if it's a one-time investment of solar, you can even have, I don't know, right? You can even fundraise for solar panels. For sure, you can afford air conditioning during class hours.
That is correct, Karen. In fact, right now, as they build schools now in DepEd, DPWH built schools, they are now putting up solar panels. But okay. I think you're correct. It must be a policy. It must be something that is not left to the discretion of the DPWH, but it must be a policy already, policy that our schools, because what is important for a solar panel, in fact, is that it will be able to absorb the sunlight. And the Philippines, in many places in the Philippines, I think it's sunlight is so accessible. I mean, you put it in rooftop, especially for schools, you will be able now to collect enough. And I think that should, and I agree, that should be a policy and not something that is right now. In fairness, many of the school buildings have started to put up solar panels, but as a policy, I don't know if that is still has been instituted as a policy. I think it should be.
Okay. Another question is, if hypothetically the president will decide with the stakeholders that it will be babalik sa April to May, then itong darating na June, they'll have to go to school. There will be no summer break. They'd have to go straight.
Yes, probably if that if the decision is to revert back to the April, May as the summer break, then what will happen will be that there has to be some adjustment, Karen.
Yeah.
It can't be that, you know, no summer break. I think whatever happens, and I think the Department of Education, Malacañang, is reasonable enough to be able to make that decision that there must be some adjustment. It can't be suddenly just imposed. There must be some adjustment. But Karen, again, you know, the more important thing here is that I think, first, the decision to about the academic calendar, based on what I heard earlier, it's now being based on data and science, and I think that is important. I think we should not just shift because we just want to shift. It must be well studied and must be laid down to the Filipino people so that they understand. And once they understand, Filipino people really accept that. Secondly, once we accept whatever,
you don't have an opinion just yet.
Because I don't have the data on the number of days that have been suspended during the rainy season. Because three academic calendars or two academic calendars, if you recall, we were forced really to go online because of the pandemic. And there were more pressing issues rather than to decide on the summer, the academic calendar. I think the academic calendar then was made flexible by a law simply because we just wanted to ensure the health and safety of our teachers and our students.
Yeah.
But now, I think, like tomorrow, I'll have a committee meeting. I think that is one thing that we will also be asking, that we be presented with the data on the number of classes affected during the rainy season.
Yes.
Of course, right now, we all know what's happening right now. So it's easy to compare. But more importantly also is that we bring in the experts like Pag-asa and, of course, the views of some stakeholders. But a decision must be made at the soonest possible time because education here, we can't really keep our students always guessing. May paso ba today? Kailan ba mag-uumpisa? They need some stability. They need some definiteness in what they're doing.
Oo, pero tama po kayo kasi nga mainit ang April and May pero mas konti ang bagyo. Parang hindi nga tayo gaano nakaranas eh. Pero pag June, July, sunod-sunod ang pag-ulan and yung baha. Right?
Yes.
Oo. Okay. So that will be that would be an ongoing discussion for sure. I want to ask you now more. I know you've been passionate about education. It's been your advocacy also for such a long time. I'm going to read to you some of the data that I have right now. Learning poverty in the Philippines, and this is according to the World Bank, the numbers are frankly staggering and scary. By June 2022, the country's learning poverty is now at 90.9%. In 2019, it was 69.5%. So ngayon, 90.9% ang learning poverty. How is that defined for our viewers? It's the inability to read or understand a simple text or story at 10 years old. So clearly at 10 years old, that would be like, I would presume grade 4. Ganun po ba ang 10, no? Tama, no? So hindi na po nakakaintindi, nakakabasa ang 90.9% of our 10-year-olds. And the latest numbers show that we are hitting rock bottom compared to, let's say, Malaysia or Indonesia. What are we doing, Congressman? Are we changing what we are teaching our kids in the early years?
Hi, Karen. First, very briefly, I think if I read the same World Bank report, uh-oh, I think we should also emphasize the word, it was really an estimate. It's not based on any survey or any really in-depth study. It's an estimate they have because based on the learning loss that they estimated because it was online during the pandemic. But be that as it may, I think we all accept the fact that the PISA exam, the SEA PLM exam, the TIMSS exam showed even pre-pandemic that we were not faring well. But again, all these things I think should be looked at in the proper context. First, if you recall, when we took the PISA exam, that was the time that we were just adjusting on using the mother tongue. So there we have about 180 languages in the Philippines. When we took the PISA exam, we were asked, what language do you want? We chose English because we had no choice. You could not choose any of the 180. We have 19 major dialects, languages, by the way, Karen. So again, that adjustment by itself of being taught in your mother tongue or in Tagalog or whatever or language, and then suddenly taking the exam in English, I think takes a toll also on the students. I think we should take that into account. I only say that simply because, Karen, Filipino students, based on my experience with them, my going around, when I talk to students, Filipino students are smart. So this is not a reflection of the capacity of our Filipino students. I think there were factors, but the PISA exam was also good, Karen. Why? Because it gave us a chance now to take a look at data, comparing data with other countries. One data that was shown, Karen, was that the Philippines, despite it being not faring well, we have one of the longest hours of studying. We have a lot of subjects being taught. So what does that tell that? What does that tell us? We should decongest.
Correct.
8-12.
Yes.
K-12 was a good idea, but let's decongest the subjects. Let us, example, for the mother tongue, what I'm saying there is that the mother tongue is good if it's understood and there are materials on it. So let's not make that mandatory. Let's give the teachers the flexibility to teach whatever language, as long as the student learns grades 1-3, reading.
No, but then it will matter. You need to institutionalize that because the books, I mean, for example, the mother tongue debate is quite a new debate, huh? Because when I went to school, that was in the 1970s, obviously, they taught English, right? So my generation, our generation actually speaks English quite well. I had to learn Filipino on television, and it's easy to learn. But English to learn as a second language could be a bit harder. So all the books I had before were in English. So ang tanong kasi nito, if we give teachers the choice, what books are we printing?
Again, maybe just to clear and understand what I said, the K-12 says it's mandatory that we use mother tongue. What I'm saying is that we should adjust that, not make it mandatory. Right now, you're correct, Karen. Most of the books we have are in English, are in the English language. So we should use
that. Yung sa K-12? Yung sa mababa, yung K, kinder to, let's say, grade 1 to 2, hindi na ka-mother tongue yun.
Yun ang mandatory, yung 1 to 3, mandatory yan. So, but then most of our textbooks, our books are still in the English language because it's really very difficult. Karen, we should give it a little time because the agency in charge of alphabetizing all our different languages and dialects is the Komisyon ng Wikang Filipino, the KWF.
Yeah.
If you ask the KWF, it's not that easy to alphabetize all the languages, even the 19 major languages. We have to give them time so that they are able to finish alphabetizing that. Once they do that, the next phase there is books. So that's, again, that's another challenge. That's not going to be that easy to make books because you have to check, double check, triple check, and all these things. Yeah. So again, while we're not at that stage yet, the point is, let's allow our teachers to teach first according to our constitution. English first, and if possible, Filipino. That is what the constitution says. And then once the mother tongue textbooks, materials are developed, then by all means, let's start reintroducing. But Karen, there are still places in the Philippines, like there are IT schools that excel because all of them are well-versed in their mother tongue.
In the mother tongue.
That should continue. Whatever works wherein the student will learn, let's use that. Let's adjust. Let's just make sure that our students learn to read and they understand what they're reading, the comprehension is there, and of course, mathematics.
Okay.
That is one adjustment that, and of course, we have to limit the number of subjects.
Yes.
That's been shown already. Again, we should reduce the number of subjects.
That's it. Wait, two things. You pointed something really good today, which I frankly was quite surprised. The Constitution states you have to teach in English.
Well, the constitution, the medium of instruction, until otherwise, unless there's a law that says otherwise, it's really...
But right now, it's English.
English and Filipino. But the K-12 says we teach now in the mother tongue.
Yeah, but how could you make a law that frankly doesn't agree with the constitution?
Oh, the constitution provides unless otherwise provided by the law.
All right, so that's one. Number two, has that been decided on? Let's say, for example, what is it right now? Grade 1 to 3. I remember Senator Coco Pimentel, he said this, I think we should just teach English, math, good manners and right conduct. Is it just four subjects really, but focus on English and math? Is it like that today in grade one? How many subjects?
Well, right now that's not the way it is yet. In fact, I think if you recall, during the basic education report of the Vice President, the Secretary of Education, Sara, she said that they are almost finished, or they finished already with the curriculum for 1 to 10, and they are just, I think, in their final consultations before they bring that out to the public and that is implemented. Hopefully, that the revised K-10 curriculum would entail some reduction of subjects. If you recall, during the time of Secretary Briones, what she did was reduce the number of competencies because the K-12 made it competencies. So under the original K-12, it was 15,000 plus competencies. Secretary Briones reduced that to a little more than 5,000. But what we're saying is that we reduce it, not only competencies, but it is the subject. But Karen, that will come with critics, because some will always say that here we go again, we're not adjusting to the future. No, in fact, what we want is the basics, the functional literacy, learning how to read and understanding what one reads, including mathematics, and that is correct. During the last Congress, we reintroduced the GMRC for grades 1 to 6. We should really focus on these things. It is not reverting to an old way. It is going back to the basics, ensuring that our Filipino students are well equipped and they're smart enough to be able to be able to teach themselves once we teach them the basics, learning how to read and understanding what they read. As you said, World Bank says by grade 10 years old, one must know how to reading comprehension must be there. But based on their own study, it seems that it is lacking in the Philippines. So we should adjust. That is the point.
Congressman, Karen, I think the point, more... Karen, yeah, go on.
I just want to point out, when it comes to legislation, we should not legislate subjects. We should not legislate the way of teaching. I think that should be left to the teachers. That should be left to the principals. That should be left to the Department of Education. That should not be the subject of legislation, because one size will not fit all. Flexibility is really required in education.
Okay. My last question is, all these years, not just this administration, but all these years, what have we done wrong? We should be getting better. Why are we getting worse? That's the question, right? Yeah. Now that there's just, I mean, so many instruments available to aid us in the world, why is the Philippines dipping? Bakit parang yung 30 years ago na nag-aral or 40 years ago, they learned better? Yeah. Bakit, Congressman?
Yeah. Yes, what? Karen, actually, I don't want to second guess what happened, but this is it. I think the way I look at it is that really, let's face reality. Filipinos are, not because I'm a Filipino, but Filipinos are naturally smart. I mean, you can really see that. Maybe what happened was that we started to congest and just keep on giving data, wanting them to step up more and more. But I think we should just go back to the basics of reading, and mathematics. And the Filipino, being smart, will be able to fend for himself, herself, be able to teach himself, herself. During the pandemic, if we just had reading comprehension before that, I think whether we used modules or we used online, learning would not have been, the loss would not have been that big. Maybe it's because we just really congested too much the curriculum of our students. Maybe... Uh-oh.
It alone, or the fact we don't have enough classrooms, our teachers are poorly paid, so to speak, they leave. So you have teachers right now who are also challenged in terms of their own skills.
Yes, there are many factors. I agree, Karen. But I think the basic thing is that a Filipino, even during the 50s, the 60s, you could see those who graduated that time excelled. Yeah. Our fathers, our grandfathers, they know their subjects very well. So the point is really, it's really for us to decongest, allow the Filipino, give the Filipino the basics and allow them to develop, to grow by themselves. They will do it. And that has been proven by the generations before us.
On that note, I want to thank you for joining me today, Chairperson of Basic Education in the Lower House, Congressman Roman Romolo. Thank you, sir. I hope to have you again.
Thank you, Karen, and thank you to everyone. God bless.
All right. God bless you, sir. That